I'll start with you here. Yesterday, we made a big deal. We had this stat up that showed that more of the public believed Cohen than the president, 50 to 35. We joked, that's a credibility problem. Michael Cohen wasn't the most credible person. That's amazing. So not surprised that Michael Cohen continues to have credibility problems.
And it helps the president's argument. I mean, if you and that
does it, what does it help
does,
though? What
in
does
the
it
sense
help?
That the president's argument has been, what are you going to believe this guy? He's already a liar, a proven liar. Everything he says is lies. Why would you believe it? And so then he goes in and he has what, if you're not paying really, really close attention to it, can sound like he went and didn't tell the truth. Well, the other thing I would say is, if you're Michael Cohen, don't you go into this next testimony really making sure every single word you say is absolutely true and bulletproof.
But I understand why I think the White House, they see a chance to knock Cohen down.
Yeah.
But this doesn't help the president's story, because the president's attorneys were reaching out to Cohen.
What are your lawyers doing talking to this guy about the pardon?
They were certainly
pending his testimony.
There's something else there.
They say?
Except that gives you distance.
Right.
The president could say, well, my lawyers did that.
Yeah. If you want this cloud of confusion, if you want it to be a he said, she said, this is what Jim Jordan argued with you about on Sunday.
Yeah.
This is the argument that Cohen's a liar. He lied about this, that, and the other. He goes in and says, I never sought a role in the administration, when apparently anyone in Jason Table and Rouse knew that he wanted a role in the administration. And this is just another example of undercutting his own credibility by being a mendacious mook. I mean, it just doesn't make sense.
Bob Bauer, it continues. I've always thought it was a real risk for Democrats on the House to make Michael Cohen, this very extraordinarily flawed witness, as essentially the first witness in the unofficial, whatever you want to call them, against the president. All right, I know they don't have, but they did. He's been the first star attraction. We all knew going in this was a credibility problem, and sure enough, he couldn't even get his mea culpa right.
I'd make two points in response to that. First of all, while I realize the situations are different, by the same token, John Dean was the star witness against Richard Nixon. And the power of the witness lies in the role that they had with the president. He was the president's personal lawyer, as well as, of course, having a role in the campaign. So he's really an indispensable witness, even with the credibility flaws. The second point I would make is, in the short term, his credibility has taken a hit, no question. In the long term, he's opened up a whole line of inquiry about how the president's lawyers were using the suggestion of pardons during periods of time when people were shaping up their testimony, preparing, as Michael Cohen was, to deal with major legal problems. And I would just conclude by linking that to the issues that have been raised now about the Trump Organization's payment of his legal fees, what their intention was in paying those fees, and why they stopped paying them once he began cooperating with the special counsel.
Saul, I think no one, I'll be honest, I don't think anybody's shocked that Michael Cohen's been out for Michael Cohen the whole time. All right? And that is, frankly, prosecutors count on potential witnesses flipping to be worried more about themselves than anybody else. You could make a case that this is actually consistent with everything we've learned about Michael Cohen.
Well, here's what I would say about that. And Bob Bauer made a very important comparison, which is Michael Cohen to John Dean. But here's the key difference. When John Dean decided to go over to the prosecution team, he told the truth. And he was incredibly well prepared by his lawyer when he testified in front of the Senate, the Irvin Committee, the Senate Watergate Committee. This was, I have to say, a failure in preparation by his lawyer. And I don't care whether his lawyer is pro bono or not. Mm-hmm. You would shed your client and you say, look, you're going to go out there and you're going to tell the truth about everything, the good and the bad. And to just take one example, when he was saying repeatedly that he never defrauded a bank, which is completely inconsistent to the facts he admitted to in the Southern District of New York, his attorney should have asked for a recess and woodshedded him and said, you can't say that. Here's what your plea papers say. And here's the crazy thing about it. Cohen, the stuff that they caught him not telling the truth about is all really tangential stuff.
Right?
It's not even stuff that's important. For God's sake, admit that you wanted a job. Admit that you defrauded the bank. You already pled guilty to those facts. But the key stuff that he testified to has already been corroborated by his plea in the Southern District of New York. I can guarantee you he didn't say anything about the hush money payments that he hadn't said to the prosecutors in the Southern District of New York, and they did believe him. So I think it was a very unfortunate preparation of this witness by his lawyer.
Bob, is that a fair? He makes a pretty strong case about preparation.
In fairness, lawyers sometimes have only so much sway with their clients. Think about lawyers who've been representing Donald Trump and begging him, assume, to stop tweeting.
Sure.
So who knows what material they were working with here? He probably got 97%, 95% of it the way they wanted. And then, unfortunately, because he's, you know, maybe not the best client in the world, he slipped off the road.
Gene, I go back to, you know, this is the danger of Michael Cohen. And this is the danger of all the people that you're trying to get to flip. By the way, let's say they had gotten Paul Manafort to flip.
Mm-hmm.
What would they be saying about him?
Exactly. He's a liar. He's been a liar earlier. He lied about this. He lied about that. You know, in part, this is the nature of this sort of proceeding, right? Who knows about crimes? Criminals, other criminals, right, who participated in crimes and then got caught and then decided to talk about it so they don't go to jail for as long a time. I mean, that's who your witnesses are. So I actually think Saul raises a very good point in that not that the lawyer, not that Cohen's lawyer had complete control over what he said. You don't know what they're going to say.
I've always defended Jay Sekulow, for instance, when he got supposedly caught lying to me. He's got a client that doesn't always tell everything.
Exactly.
Yeah.
In some ways, you have Michael Cohen, who's just done this for so long, and he's now trying to turn over this new leaf, but you still are who you are in some ways, so you're seeing a little bit of that.
To quote the great Dennis Green, you are who we thought you were, Michael Cohen. Anyway, Bob Bauer, Saul Weisenberg. Gentlemen, thank you, guys. Hello, YouTubers. If you're watching this, it means you've checked out our channel, so thank you. Now do me a favor, subscribe by clicking on that button down there. Click on any of the videos to watch the latest interviews and highlights from MTP Daily and MSNBC. You can get more Meet the Press content every morning in the First Read newsletter. If you're tired of content that you don't know anything about where it came from, you don't have to have that problem with us. NBC News, MSNBC, MTP, and the Meet the Press mindset right here for you on YouTube. Subscribe now.